Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to welcome you all to the opening ceremony of the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting in Rovinj. Allow me to start our evening by introducing Dr. Alexander Vishnevac, chair of the organizing committee of the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting. Dr. Vishnevac will officially open the meeting. Dr. Vishnevac.
Good evening, good afternoon. Dear Madam Assistant Minister of the Science, Education and Sports of the Republic of Croatia, dear Mr. President of the European Crystallographic Association, dear colleagues, dear friends, dear partners, dear fellow crystallographers, welcome to Rovinj, welcome to the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting opening ceremony. On this day, 23rd of August 2015. It's been 4 years since the European Crystallographic Association entrusted us with the organization of this meeting. It was in Madrid back in 2011 at the IOCR Congress and General Assembly. Ever since, we have understood this occasion as a token of appreciation of our European colleagues and friends, but also as a great responsibility. From day zero to the present day, we still think that it has been a great responsibility and that it still is. And since the very day first, we have been supported by a number of institutions and personalities, distinguished institutions and personalities from the Croatian political, scientific, and cultural elite. Let me first mention the Ministry of Science, Education, and Sports, the institution that has supported the organization of ECM very generously. And on behalf of this ministry, I have a pleasure to welcome here Madam Ružica Beljo Lučić, Assistant Minister of Science, Education and Sports of the Republic of Croatia. May I have a big hand for Madam Lučić, please. Secondly, I would like to mention the support, especially in the very early days, of the Croatian Academy of Sciences and Arts. We owe a lot of gratitude to this institution that has been supporting us from the very beginning, especially in the early days of the process when this support was much more appreciated than now and then when we needed it much more than now. And finally, I have to mention that the former president of the Republic of Croatia, Professor Ivo Josipović, while still holding the office, wrote a personal letter to the councillors of the European Crystallographic Association supporting our bid in Madrid. Even though Ivo probably doesn't listen to me now, I would like to thank him for that as well. But these are Croatians. We owe no less appreciation to our colleagues and friends from the international crystallographic community. Not only has the European Crystallographic Association entrusted us with the organization of ECM29, but they have been so supportive and so nice to us that I have to thank especially to the president, Professor Andreas Roth, for his friendship and support from the very beginning. Thank you, Andre. Then, International Union of Crystallography. They have provided a generous, very generous support that qualified them as a gold sponsor of the ECM29. And this support enabled us to cover partly or entirely the accommodation and travel expenses for 55, if I'm not mistaken, young crystallographers, young scientists from 26 countries, which was important to them and crucial to them to be able to attend the meeting. Not only has the IOCR supported us in the financial sense, they have been supportive in every other sense. So I need to say thank you to Marvin Hackert, to Mike Dacombe, to Michele Zema, Andrea Sharp, Brian McMahon, many others. Thank you very much. And finally, this is probably the most pleasurable duty that I will have during this little speech, our fellow organizers of the previous ECMs. Their answers, swift answers, their bright tips, comments, support was priceless during the whole process of the organization, and they exactly know what are we going through. Thank you very much, Elspeth Garman, Sandy Blake, and Carl Wilhelm Tornros. And finally, am I forgetting something? Sorry. Oh, yes. There would be no success in this high-tech dependent science as crystallography is without the smart engineers and developers who are producing, designing this cutting-edge technology that we are going to see these days. There would be no successful ECM29 without the generous support and help of our sponsors and exhibitors. There are very many, and they have been very generous and helpful. But they are led this year by our diamond partners, Bruker and Incotech, and our platinum sponsor, Rigaku. Thank you guys for trusting us. Last but not the least, I have been working over these 4 years with 12 wonderful co-workers of mine in the organizing committee and many others in the program committee. Thanks to these people who didn't spare their efforts or time or work, ECM seems to be a success today. We have 50 microsymposia, 16 keynote lectures, 2 beautiful plenary lectures. We have 1,069 registered participants. They told me we beat all the records. I don't know. Anyway, I would really like to have a big hand for my co-workers from the organizing and program committee who did a marvelous job over these 4 years of preparations. Thank you. The organizing committee has set up the team of young crystallographers, mostly the PhD students or the postdocs from the Ruđer Bošković Institute and University of Zagreb. You'll recognize them by this cute orange t-shirts. They will be on your disposal for any assistance you might need during these 4 or 5 days of the conference. Until now, they have done a marvelous job. I would also like to ask, I'm asking a lot of applauses, but I need so much to show appreciation for the hard work that has been done and for the support that we have received during this process. So for the young people that are here with us, thank you very much. And finally, I am welcoming all of you to Rovinj, to Croatia, to the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting, which, by the way, I'm pronouncing open now. And I hope that you will have a very fruitful and successful meeting, that you will get many new friendships, partnerships, that you will get new ideas that will hopefully open new bright avenues in your scientific research. And I also hope that you will have a wonderful time in this, you will see that extraordinary country of ours. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Višnjevac. It is my honor to announce Professor Ružica Beljo Lučić, Assistant to Minister of Science, Education and Sports of the Republic of Croatia.
Thank you. Dear ladies and gentlemen, distinguished colleagues from Europe, from Croatia, from the whole world. I'm very delighted to be here today with you and to have opportunity to greet you all as representative of the government of the Republic of Croatia and the Ministry of Science, Education and Sports at this opening of a conference which I'm well aware is immensely important to you, members of the international community of scientists whose life and work are devoted to the crystallography. Recognizing the importance of this area of science, the United Nations proclaimed last year, 2014, as the International Year of Crystallography. We are proud of the fact that in 2015, Croatia was chosen as the location for the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting. I have never been, I have to say, at so large conference, and I'm really impressed with this. And I have to wish, and I want to wish to express my gratitude to the Croatian Association of Crystallographers for its efforts in organizing this amazing event, which is being held in the very beautiful Istrian town of Rovinj under the sponsorship of the Ministry of Science, Education and Sports. Time and again, we stress the importance of integrating Croatian science into world trends. Large international events, meetings such as this one, play a key role in this process and in the internationalization of Croatian science. The Croatian crystallographic community, although relatively small, is highly motivated and has a strong tradition, as well as a rich share of expertise to offer. The Ministry of Science, Education and Sports is therefore eager to offer support behind its efforts, as we heard. Apart from seasoned scientists from all over Europe, the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting will pull young scientists, all of whom will, over the next few days, have an opportunity to jointly participate in seminars, workshops, and interactive discussions, and in so doing, facilitate the exchange of experiences and knowledge. Indeed, I'm confident that this meeting will pave the way towards the new cooperation opportunities and that new partnership will be built. With this in mind, please allow me to thank you all for coming to Croatia and to wish 29th European Crystallographic Meeting much success. Have a nice and pleasant stay in Rovinj, and thank you very much for attention.
Thank you, Professor Beljo Lučić. We shall continue with a lovely musical performance. We shall hear our local singers, whose work is recognized and protected by UNESCO since 2013. They will be performing traditional Croatian songs a cappella. Please give them a big applause. Klapa Motovun! Thank you, Klapa Motovun. It was a really splendid performance and we all enjoyed it. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Professor Stanko Popović, President of the Croatian Crystallographic Association.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear crystallographers, dear friends, it's a great honor for me to welcome all of you on behalf of the Croatian Crystallographic Association, CCA. Thanks very much to all of you who have come to Rovinj, one of the pearls of Croatia, to attend the ECM29. Let me describe in short the early days of our adventure, ECM29. Petra Bombic, the secretary of the ECA, sent in April 2011 the letter to the CCA. The venue of the ECM29 in 2015 will be decided by the ECA Council meeting this year in Madrid. The ECA Executive Committee discussed that Croatia may be one of the bidders. As Croatia is a national member of the ECA, there is a significant crystallographic activity in the country, and there has been no ECM organized in Croatia earlier. The CCA answered 4 days later, "Dear Petra Bombic, thanks very much for your suggestion that ECM29 could be held in Croatia. The CCA accepts this suggestion with pleasure and would like to express sincere thanks to the ECA Executive Committee. We believe that we will be able to present more details on the ECM29 during the ECA Council meeting in Madrid." The CCA formed a bid committee chaired by Aleksandar Višnjevac. This body started with great enthusiasm the preparation of the bid with the wish to host the ECM29 in Rovinj. We asked eminent European crystallographers to support our intention to host the ECM29, the response was great. We received many letters of support. Also, a letter of support was received from the academician Zvonko Kusic, the president of the Croatian Academy of Sciences and Arts. The time for the preparation of the bid was short, and the bid committee worked very hard. We expected anxiously the ECA Council meeting. Pancha Naumov, a friend of ours, sent a message. "Congratulations on the beautiful presentation submitted by Aleksandar. I strongly hope that the decision will be in your favor." Indeed, the voting was really in our favor. Our small team in Madrid was very happy, as well as all of us in Croatia who expected the news. So the organization of the ECM29 was obtained. There has been no retreat now. Alea jacta est. Let us organize the ECM29. We have considered the ECM29 as a great recognition of crystallographic achievements in our country by the international scientific community. In October 2011, the CCA nominated the organizing committee, chaired by Aleksandar Višnjevac and co-chaired by Marijana Đaković, outlined the program committee chaired by Nenad Ban. Maria Luic was elected the chair of the ECM. In August 2012, the Croatian Association of Crystallographers was founded as a legal entity which took over the organization of the ECM. The decision was approved by the assembly of the CCA, namely the CCA is the scientific council of the Croatian Academy and as such is not appropriate for the organization of the ECM. The logo of CIC. The history of crystallography in Croatia will be presented by my dear friend Biserka Kojić Prodić in the scope of MS49. Let me mention here only several facts. Crystallography in Croatia began with courses in mineralogy in the 1870s. In 1966, the crystallographers in the former Yugoslavia established a center of crystallography chaired by Drago Grdenic, the founder of modern crystallography in Croatia. The center acted under the auspices of the Academy of Sciences and Arts in Croatia. That same year, the center joined the IUCR and the European Crystallographic Committee. Boris Kamenar was the vice president and president of the ECC. This is Professor Drago Gradinic, and this is Professor Boris Kamenar on the left, ECM7 in Jerusalem. From 66 to 91, the center organized 25 annual and 6 Italian Yugoslav conferences. The invited speakers were eminent crystallographers, among others, the Nobel Prize winner, Dorothy Hodgkin. The center published the annual of Crystallography, a journal containing plenary lectures and short contributions. Due to the war in Yugoslavia, the ECM-13 that has been scheduled in Ljubljana in 1991 was transferred to Trieste thanks to the friendship among crystallographers in Italy, Croatia, and Slovenia. During the ECM-13, a plenary lecture was given by the Nobel winner Robert Huber, and a satellite meeting on synchrotron radiation was organized. After the proclamation of independence of Croatia, the Croatian following Academy dissolved the center and, following the support of the crystallographers in Croatia, founded the Croatian Crystallographic Association in February 92. The CCA joined soon ECA and IUCR. Since 92, the CCA and the Slovenian Crystallographic Society have been organizing annual meetings with international participation, alternately in Slovenia and Croatia. 23 meetings so far. The reports on the meetings can be found in the IUCR newsletter. An extended paper, Crystallography in Croatia, was published in the IUCR newsletter. Some photos from our previous meetings. Biograd, plenary lecturers. Excursion to Kornati Archipelago. Plenary lectures in Logarska Dolina last year. The CCA has 100 members now who study biologically active molecules, proteins, organometallic compounds, pharmaceuticals, microstructure of composites and its relation to physical, chemical, and biological properties. In spite of great efforts in organization of this ECM, the crystallographers in Croatia performed a series of activities during the IUCR. For instance, Contemporary Crystallography in Croatia, a scientific conference, the proceedings published by the Croatian Academy. Hot topics in contemporary crystallography, the workshop for young crystallographers. The 23rd Slovenian-Croatian Crystallographic Meeting in Slovenia. Popular lectures in scientific institutions and professional societies. English-Croatian Dictionary of Crystallography, 1,710 years, published by the Institute of the Croatian Language and Linguistics. A special issue of the Croatian journal, Priroda, that's Nature, containing papers by Croatian crystallographers. 100 Years of Crystallography by Biserka Kojić Prodić and Krešimir Molčanov, review in the Croatian journal, Chemistry and Industry. Chemical Crystallography Before X-ray Diffraction by Molčanov and Stelinović, a review in Angewandte Chemie. Nikola Tesla, scientist and inventor, discovery of X-rays, published in Distinguished Croatian Scientist in the World, Croatian American Society. Crystallography in Croatia, a review in Chemistry and Industry. Promotion brochure, Crystallography Matters, translated in Croatian. Crystal growing competition, participants being pupils in primary and secondary schools. Popular lectures on crystallography during the summer school of physics for pupils of secondary schools. The Croatian crystallographers cordially invite you, all the members of the crystallography community, to attend the 3rd European Crystallographic School and the 24th Croatian-Slovenian Crystallographic Meeting to be held in the famous tourist resort of Bol, the island of Brač, in September 2016. At the end, my sincere thanks to all members of the organizing and program committee, and to our PCO Globetour event for the marvelous work in organization of the ECM29. To the ECA Executive Committee and to Andreas Roth personally, to SIG and GIG representatives, to IUCR, to all members of the Croatian crystallographic community, to the Croatian Academy of Sciences and Arts, to the Croatian government, to the Croatian National Tourist Board, to all sponsors for their support of the ECM29. Many thanks to all of you, the participants, hoping that you will keep your stay in Rovinj and in Croatia in a nice memory. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Popovic. I invite Professor Andreas Roth, President of the European Crystallographic Association, to address the audience.
Distinguished guests, Madam Assistant from the Ministry, Minister of the Department of Science, Art and Sport, colleagues from all over the globe, I have to say, but in particular, young students. It has been mentioned twice already how important the young students basically are, but I cannot emphasize that enough. It is because of you that we have a vision that in 20 and 30 and 50 years' time, we will still be practicing this lovely subject of ours. So a particular welcome to all of you. I have to say, 2 days ago, to be precisely at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, a few colleagues here and I have boarded a plane in a place called Skukuza in South Africa, in the Kruger National Park, where we've been watching lions and we've been discussing science. But this was nothing compared to what I am experiencing now. Alex, Maria, Mariana, we're here. This is it. It's incredible how quickly this 4 years basically went by. And in Afrikaans, we have a story or a little comment joke which says, die hond het die bus gevang, nou weet hy nie wat om daarmee te doen nie. The dog has caught the bus, but he doesn't know what to do with it. But now I am pretty sure you know exactly what to do with this bus. So the dynamics also of the Croatian Crystallographic Association has been highlighted by a few colleagues here. But I think a manifestation of the activities and the proactive activities of the Croatian Crystallographic Association is specifically evident in the invitation to the third Crystallographic School of the European Crystallographic Association next year already. As if this conference is not enough, they are already planning 1 year ahead to host the European Crystallographic School. So for that, and also for hosting us here, we really thank you all. I am sure this is going to be one of those memorable conferences. I am sure that Santiago and also Katerina, and those following after this meeting here in Rovinj will have a lot of pressure on them to host a meeting of this quality. But I have to say, what I experienced from the council the day after the presentation was made in Madrid, we were basically sold on this venue when you showed this island and Rovinj, Alex. That did the trick. So, I'm also crazy about Croatia. This is my fifth time here, and I'm enjoying every moment of it. But not only for the scenic part of Croatia, but also for the fantastic and really warm friendship and the dynamics of all the young people here. I cannot stress that enough. When I go to the University of Zagreb and I speak to the young people there, it is this move and dynamics that you experience all the time. So I really would like to congratulate you young ones again. Please continue with your activities. Please continue with building out crystallography. And I would like to challenge also all the visitors, the senior visitors, make a point to talk extra to the young people, not only the Croatians, but also the young people from all over the world. Because, as I said just now, you young guys that's where our future in crystallography lies. So all of the best with this meeting, all the most success. It's a pity that these 4 days will fly basically just like that, but we will have 4 days of dynamics and we will remember it for the rest of our lives. So all the best. Thank you very much for inviting me to be here, and I hope you have a fantastic conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Roth. We continue with our singers. Klapa Motovun.
Freuden cross passike, Freuden cross passike, Freuden cross passike.
Kao mladu lozu. se moja mladost ruka ovim neverama zjuka.
Thank you, Klapa Motovun. The Max Perutz Prize is awarded in recognition of meritorious achievements in any branch of crystallography by a crystallographer having a clear affiliation with the European Crystallographic Association region and being an individual member of the association. The winner of the 8th Max Perutz Prize is Professor John Helliwell. The prize will now be awarded. I invite Professor John Helliwell, as well as Professor Alessia Bacchi and Professor Andreas Roth to come to the stage.
It is a great pleasure for me to announce that the 8th Perutz Prize of the European Crystallographic Association has been awarded by two professors, John Helliwell. And the motivation is, you can read it, for his long, generous, and fruitful dedication to developing all aspects of the use of synchrotron radiation for crystallography, and for his boosting support to global development of synchrotron and neutron facilities. In addition to his pioneering achievements and to the key role that he played in the development of experimental beam lines for structural biology worldwide, he also has been constantly engaged in outreach and dissemination of crystallography to the scientific community. So, most of people in this audience surely know John personally or by knowing his excellent and glamorous scientific career. But I want just to sketch an outline of his achievements here before delivering the prize. Also for, as was said before, for young people who can see how a big scientist will develop his career. So John led the development of the world's first dedicated protein crystallography in beam lines. He pioneered the collection of the first broadband Lowell diffraction patterns for protein and virus crystals using synchrotron radiation. He combined the biochemistry, spectroscopy, microscopy, protein crystallography, and small angle scattering to study the crustaceans. He contributed to some of the first developments of synchrotron radiation for phasing based on optimized anomalous scattering and began the investigations of the effect of radiation damage and its potential use for phasing, demonstrating the use of MID phasing for ab initio structure determination, from powder diffraction data. John had also some really key roles, important roles in serving the community. He served the global crystallographic community through numerous advisory committees' responsibilities to ensure a speedy and effective growth at as many synchrotrons and neutron facilities as possible. He was the first chair of the IOCR Commission on Synchrotron Radiation. He was president of the European Crystallographic Association between 2006 and 2009, and served as editor-in-chief of the IOCR journals. So this is the big career, the big science that we have here to award with the Max Perutz Prize. And this is the committee who decided the winner of the prize, and it's my pleasure to deliver the prize, award the prize to John. So now Professor John Helliwell will give his Max Perutz Prize lecture. Please, John. This is yours.
Well, thank you, everyone, dear colleagues. And thank you, above all, the ECA for this Max Perutz Award. It is obviously a big honor, and I am very glad about it, and I wish to thank everybody who was involved in the procedure. Thank you so much. I wish to take you back, first of all, to challenges in the mid-1970s when I entered the field. There was weak diffraction and long exposure times in the home lab for macromolecular crystallography. We called it protein crystallography. To me, solving the crystallographic phase problem was haphazard. I was fortunate to hear Mossbauer in his lecture at the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory near Oxford, where he took some time, a short period of time, but describing overall his Mossbauer effect and his Nobel Prize winning work. Nevertheless, he took time to explain his ideas for the use of nuclear anomalous dispersion for the phase determination in protein crystallography. The impact of that was particularly striking for me as a young PhD student. Our field was important. The IUCR book, Anomalous Scattering, was just published in 1975. It was a fertile time, I felt, for a physicist like me entering protein crystallography. On my interview day, I met several potential supervisors, and one of them said, "Don't bother, all the methods are fine as they are." Fortunately, I wasn't put off. And Dorothy Hodgkin provided me with a preprint of work that had come to her notice in Stanford at the Synchrotron Radiation Laboratory, and she asked my opinion about it. That was the kind of very fortunate environment that I found myself working in. And the team is here, led by Keith Hodgson, Alex Vladauer, who's in the audience, Jim Phillips, and Margaret Yevitz. And here is their paper, which actually eventually came out in the PNAS journal. Their first reference was to the work Rosenbaum, Holmes and Witz, published in 1971 in Nature, on the use of synchrotron radiation for biological diffraction, mainly, but not exclusively, on muscle diffraction. Here is Ken Holmes. Here is Gerd Rosenbaum. I haven't got a picture of John Witz. The first sentence of this paper was that the use of synchrotron radiation in protein crystallography was controversial. There was no controversy. It was really exciting and important, this development. That was my report back to Dorothy Hodgkin. In the IUCR book was this chapter from Walter Hoppe and his colleague Jakubowski. And here is a photograph of Walter Hoppe, who I would have loved to have met, but he passed away before I could. And in this chapter, they use conventional X-ray source, two different X-ray tubes, two wavelengths, to phase the protein erythrochororin. It was an iron-containing protein. And so they varied the real and anomalous, real and imaginary components of the dispersion coefficients of the iron. And in this conventional phasing diagram, you vary the F prime and you have the F double prime perpendicular to the F prime, and you can get a unique phase determination. And this is the two wavelengths reflection phasing method. It was in fact based on the principle and mathematics of Ray Papinsky, American crystallographer, and his co-author Okaya, which was published in 1956. So the combination of synchrotron radiation as the idea and the methodology of Hoppe and Jakubowski and Okaya and Papinsky, if you combine those two, something really dramatic could happen. And so it was my good fortune to have the chance to lead on the first dedicated X-ray source, the synchrotron radiation source at Darsbury Laboratory near Warrington, the bending magnet 7, the second instrument on the beamline, the first dedicated protein crystallography station. The design was to make a fully tunable instrument, and the wavelength coverage was from 1.2 to 2.6 angstroms. Here is the team on the right-hand side here. And the SRS performance, the universal curve for synchrotron radiation for the bending magnet and for a later superconducting wiggler, is shown here. And here is the diffraction pattern I recorded at a wavelength of 2.6 angstrom. The glass capillary of the sample would absorb all of the X-rays, and so I had to roll my own mylar capillary to host the lysozyme crystal. Much later, and towards the end of my talk, I used this commissioning experiment to help solve one of the crustacyanin proteins with students and colleagues. So on SRS 7.2, I gradually explored these different specific absorption edges, the nickel K edge, the iron, the manganese, and some generic wavelengths, the 2 angstrom and 2.6 angstrom. And I summarize this in a review in Reports on Progress in Physics. All this effort, to be clear, was inspired by the Stanford and the Hamburg DAISY experiments that I've already alluded to, led by Keith Hodgson, Gerd Rosenbaum, and Ken Holmes. Now, the initial SRS was not that well suited to crystallography. And in particular, you can see here in the source a rather large horizontal source size of 14 millimeters. And we wanted to match that to something like a 0.3 millimeter sample. The vertical was pretty good at 0.4 millimeters, and that was a good match to the sample. So, not that well suited, but initially I could get 20 times the home lab intensity, as well as being fully tunable. And when I added the vertically focusing mirror, this brought us up to 100 times. And this performance, we'd only just started. This was really a fantastic breakthrough. And so we got our first users from the UK and a good international interest, particularly from Sweden and the USA. And all the UK PX labs came, and various familiar faces here. I pay particular tribute to my PhD supervisor, Margaret Adams, and the great help and support that I had from Guy Dodson in particular. From Sweden, Carl Ivar Brandin and various colleagues came, and from the USA, Michael Rossman arrived pretty much immediately, and Howard Einspar and Steve Ehlich from Alabama. So an early experiment, the one from Howard Einspar, was in the protein P-lectin, shown here on the right, and he wanted to be sure what the identity of the metal ions was for the transition metal and the calcium, but he wasn't sure, because of the close atomic numbers, which one was which. And so by tuning the instrument to the manganese K-edge, one could optimize the anomalous signal of the manganese ion, and there was an increase of the calcium, but the ratio of these two peaks with the background sufficiently low identified which of the transition metal and the calcium was which in both protein subunit A and protein subunit B. And we published this in ActiCris B, and is one of the first of the use of tunable synchrotron radiation to determine elements of a protein crystal structure using optimized anomalous dispersion. The purine nucleoside phosphorylase project, also coming from Alabama, was of a different challenge. The crystals were 80% solvent content, and so it was the high intensity of our instrument that was used to good effect. And so you can see here in the projection down the symmetry axis, the very large solvent content, and the 90 kilodalton, 3 × 30 kilodalton protein is really a small fraction of the crystal volume. Charlie set up the company BioCris Pharmaceuticals using the purine nucleoside phosphorylase that was important in anti-cancer treatment as the basis for his new company, BioCris Pharmaceuticals. And this featured strongly in the Scientific American article, Drugs by Design, that he wrote with colleagues in December 1993. And it was in here that he referred to the use of the SRS and the collaboration with me. And this was the moment where my mother and father, my aunts and uncles, my cousins, decided that what I was doing was significant. Michael Rossman was working on the first mammalian virus, the common cold virus. And he came to Darsbury, and it was on SRS 7.2, and his work the previous week in Hamburg and Daisy, to work out the procedures, how to measure diffraction data on his very radiation-sensitive rhinovirus crystals. And he called that the American method, shoot first and ask questions later. To be clear, the final structure was based on diffraction data measured at the macromolecular CHESS synchrotron facility in Cornell in the USA. Because of the success of the Benny Magnet program, I was able to lead the development of an instrument on the superconducting wiggler, which was the first of its kind, and had a very useful emission down to very short wavelengths. And again, fully tunable from 0.6 to 1.5 angstrom. The superconducting wiggler was built at the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, and we worked with photographic film, but by now I was making strenuous efforts to move away from photographic film and collaborated closely with Uli Arndt from the Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge and N. Rathnonius for the fast television detector. Here is my colleague on the right, Miroslav Papis, working specifically with the fast diffractometer. Again, the virus work was particularly prominent, and David Stewart led the team with the foot and mouth disease virus structure determination based on the instrument, and from Harvard came Steve Harrison's project, the SV40, and Bob Liddington. So the front cover of my book was the foot and mouth disease virus, naturally with the permission and blessing of David Stewart, because it really was the most prominent project, and David's work featured on the BBC 9 o'clock news. It was also at this point that the spin-off into other areas of crystallography really developed. And so using the instrument and the short wavelengths in particular, Marjorie Harding led the work, working with me on the use of the high intensity for very small crystals. And we published this paper in Acta Christ B, using the FAST for a very small crystal of piperazine silicate. And it was Marjorie Harding's work on SRS 9.6 that led on to SRS 9.8, a project led by Bill Clegg, and then the community came afire with interest in synchrotron radiation, and another spill-off instrument was needed, the SRS 16.2. And all of this effort led directly on to the DLSI-19 project. I've hinted at the work that was needed to try and make a break from photographic film. I started in 1976, in fact, on the NINA parasitic synchrotron radiation facility and took all of my own equipment from Oxford in an old Morris Oxford car. And we have the two instruments that I've described in some detail. And over a period of 16 years, film, of course, was the mainstay, but the television diffractometer and then the image plate collaboration and help with the development of the Rigaku Molecular Structure Corporation, R-axis, made important inroads into solving this problem. So here again is Uli Arndt. Here's Paul Swepston, who I had various trips to Japan, and the Rigaku R-axis. And of course, these two devices, the FAST system and the R-axis, made very important contributions into home lab instrument improvements. I also worked closely with the Rutherford lab again for a multi-wire proportional chamber for the SRS. And this, although it had a low count rate, and in that sense not too well suited to high-intensity synchrotron radiation, nevertheless, it allowed very low noise measurements and important for weak signals. And with Nigel Allinson at York, who was interested in direct detection silicon CCDs, one could imagine a longer-term future replacing the television system by the charge-coupled device. So this 16-year period was a very strenuous period, as well as serving the users, but also in doing different detector development projects. Now, at this point, it's appropriate to take an overview. Things were going extremely well with the SRS at Darsbury, and really, we were almost feeling optimistic at making inroads into the detector's challenge. But the machine physicists never rest. And both from Stanford and in Europe was a new ring concept. And the two archetypical books here, the ESRF Foundation Phase Report, the Red Book, and the Stanford workshop on new rings, the use of the PEP storage ring, is on the right here. There were colossal increases in X-ray intensities from the new source, especially the undulator. The key question that was posed to us, particularly by the physicists, would the sample stand it? If we couldn't prove that they would, we wouldn't get instruments. The ACRF provided greatly improved emittance over the SRS. And so at the time of the foundation phase report, here are the performance curves of the different sources on this nearly 1 kilometer ring. The SRS, of course, was much smaller. So you have the bending magnet, of which there were two types, a 10-pole wiggler, and then the undulator, which provides this pseudo-monochromatic radiation by using a very gentle magnetic field to allow the radiation from successive poles to overlap and interfere. But by altering the magnet gap, you could tune the position of the undulator emissions, both the fundamental and the harmonics. And this is this massive ramp up in many orders of magnitude of the undulator emission that I was talking about. So with Keith Hodgson and Britt Hedman from Stanford, we got a NATO collaborative award, and my idea was that we could use the SRS full wiggler white beam to mimic the undulator monochromatic intensities from the new proposed ESRF. If the samples could stand this, then we were in business with the undulator radiation. And you can see directly on the right here, our test crystal, the gramicidin, we got nice clean diffraction, the Lowry diffraction from a 20 micron gramicidin crystal. And we published this work in PNAS, which I believe is the formative one for all of the effort with the subsequent use of the small crystals at the undulator source. Protein microcrystal diffraction and the effects of radiation damage with ultra-high flux synchrotron radiation. With Roger Furum and colleagues around Europe, I led the working group that was set up by ESRF to provide a discussion about the ESRF as a possible facility for protein crystallography. Roger Furum in particular was a close colleague and became a close friend, and sadly passed away not too long ago. We did calculations which showed that beam heating was significant. Our physicist colleagues were quite correct to push the matter at us. If we imagined an thermally isolated sample, the temperature rise was 20 Kelvin per second. And as a risk mitigation strategy, in our report, we suggested a copper stalk, some connecting grease and the crystal, and notice here the size that we were thinking of, 10 microns. So the heat could be conducted away from the sample. With Britt Hedman and Keith Hodgson again, we investigated the idea of Greg Petsko that specific radiation damage to disulfides might occur, and by using a radiation exposed sample of this protein despentapeptide insulin provided by Guy Dodson at Stanford and a zero dose data set measured at Darsbury, we did indeed see that there was the movement apart, the splitting of the disulfides. So we've got the negative density and the positive density here for where the sulfur atoms moved to. So this was clearly an area which was going to require close watching, but the basic solutions to the objections from the physicists, I think Roger and I felt were answered, and we carried forward an optimistic view in our report delivered to CERN, where the ESRP project was first based. Now, by this time, Wayne Hendrickson from the US was doing much work with the multiple wavelength method, and in particular had introduced the selenomethionine version of proteins for providing a general phasing vehicle for protein crystallography. Alphonse Heidner in Basel was inspired by this, and he approached me for a collaboration on his enzyme hydroxymethyl biolane synthase. And this was about the time that we were with now a third instrument at Daresbury and also looking to establish the ESRF Benin magnet for MAD, the ESRF BM14 project. And my young colleague, Andy Thompson, led the 9.5 project, moved to Grenoble to lead the BM14 project. But what we could see was that the anomalous Patterson from the selenium signal measured either as SRS on image plate or on the ESRF new JP MOI television detector gave equally good signals, and we could solve the structure using either data sets measured in SRS and at ESRF. But the ESRF provided 20 times intensity and 20 times reduction of data collection times immediately on the bending magnet, and of course there would be much more with the much better with the undulator. Now, this I think is a favorite slide from the archive to give us the Croatia context. And my lab undertook a MAD study at Eletra, and it was one of the longest wavelength MAD studies I think ever undertaken, certainly up to 1998. And we were invited to contribute a paper to the special issue of the Croatica Chemica Acta, and this was to in honor of the contributions to crystallography of Boris Kaminar, who Professor Popovic referred to earlier. Professor Kaminar did work with Dorothy Hodgson, Hodgkin in 1964 to 65, and was a visiting fellow in 71 to 72. But you can see here our protein, the manganese K edge, measured quite readily. The anomalous difference Patterson, the manganese signal, and the dispersive Patterson also. And we got nice electron density maps from the MAD method, including the two wavelength version, which was the original work and vision of Walter Hoppe. Here is our abstract in Croatian, and I'll just give you a moment to read that. Again, spin off into chemical crystallography, this time led by my wife, Madeline Helliwell. We investigated a zinc ULM5 that had had gallium substitution. And this was a project of Professor Slavko Kaučić and his young colleague, Dr. Natasha Zabukovic-Logar from Ljubljana. And using an 11 wavelength suite of measurements, we were able to tune around the zinc K edge and the gallium K edge and isolate specifically where we'd had the zinc substitution at the gallium sites. And so first of all, you see here the third wavelength scale to the fifth to get the zinc only. And so the precise labeling of the third and the fifth wavelengths are here. And the anomalous difference likewise at the zinc edge shows where the zinc substitution has gone. And then by homing in on the gallium, you can see where they're predominantly there from the peaks, and there is still a fraction of gallium at those two predominantly zinc substituted sites. The precise occupancy and the uncertainties of them, with the help of Eleanor Dodson, we were able to establish those, and a very good estimate of the sites of substitution. This was work done with the station scientists, John Warren and Simon Teat. Simon's now in Berkeley at the Advanced Light Source. The importance of this work in catalysis with these microporous compounds is that the tuning of the catalytic properties depends on the precise substitution of the metal atoms. And so using these tunable X-ray wavelength techniques to establish precisely where the substitution is very important to guide the design of the catalysts. Now, with an eye towards ever smaller samples, with colleagues at ESRF at the ID31 powder diffraction beamline, Andy Fitch, Rina Margulaki, now in Patras in Greece, and John Wright, exploring the potential of the multiple wavelength method for powder diffraction and using the delta F prime between two wavelengths, and obviously we have no F double prime signal because of the overlapping of the Friedel reflections in the powder rings, we were able to show not only, and this is using platinum hexabromide bound to the protein, both the isomorphous signal and also the dispersive signal from the two different wavelengths. And at ECM23 in Leuven, I described the phasing method of the single isomorphous replacement with the solvent flattening to break the phase ambiguity using MAD data. This was test data from a single crystal. And you see here the feasibility of the and the quality of the electron density on the right. This concept of using the two wavelengths and extending it to nano clusters, I think, is the potential for the X-ray laser to combine the technologies and approaches that have come from the synchrotron in the context of the new X-ray laser, and of course the fantastic peak brilliance, yet more colossal changes in the peak X-ray intensity, but now on a femtosecond time scale, would allow the investigation of nano clusters. And a good test sample, I think, will be ferritin as a first nano cluster test. And this all springs out of the collaboration with the powder diffraction people at the ESRF. Now, an unexpected development was the synchrotron Lowy method application to time resolved. In the SRS 9.6 instrument design, I had ensured that we could take the white beam onto the sample, and that's what I used in the evaluation of the gramicidin microcrystal. Keith Moffat had this vision for using the Lowy method for very fast data collection. And there were theoretical objections to that from pioneers such as Lawrence Bragg, who, in spite of making his own good use of the Lowy method, switched pretty promptly to his father's monochromatic diffractometer. But with David Cruikshank and Keith Moffat, we were able to explore the theoretical basis of the Lowy method. And as illustrated here in the front cover of Physics World, the color coding of the Lowy diffraction spots for multiplicity shows that there is a predominant origin of spots which are singles and not multiples. However, of course, you have to think about how to do the wavelength normalization for all of those different wavelength-stimulated singlet spots. Quick to join and engage with the work, and indeed the first electron density map from Lowy data was the work led by Janos Haidu, then in Oxford and now in Uppsala, and the person with the great vision for the single molecule experiment at the X-ray laser. And this was work in collaboration with my computational colleagues at Darsbury, Mike Elder and Pella Machin. The development of software and methods for processing the Lowy diffraction patterns, the handling of those spots that were harmonics, the wavelength normalization, the dealing with streaky spots, were a long-term project. And I worked closely again with Marjorie Harding and postdoc Hao Chuan, and later joined by Steffi Arst, who is now in ESRF, and also John Campbell, from the computational group at Darsbury. And with Zygmunt Derewende, for example, we were able to show that we could get mercury difference Fourier peak from a protein from the Lowy singlets, and also the Lowick deconvoluted doublets. With Anders Lilius from Lund in Sweden, we could show that in the final stages of refinement, it was entirely feasible to see a single water molecule at the catalytic zinc of the carbonic anhydrase. In small molecule crystallography, my student Dora Gomez from Merida in Venezuela, with a chlorinated compound, we could see that the process Lowy data with the Darsbury Lowy software could give the correct hand indication of the molecule in the crystal. And we also undertook a study of an organic crystal where the bulk 18 out of 20 of the hydrogen atoms were identifiable from the electron density maps from the Lowy data. So this provided the suite of validations of the Darsbury software, which was on open, was able to be put on open release in a confident manner and was widely used by the synchrotron X-ray community. Again, with Alphonse Heidner from Basel, we undertook time-resolved catalysis studies of his hydroxymethyl biolane synthase enzyme. And this was using the Lowy beamline at ESRF established by Michael Wolf. So here you see the high-quality Lowy diffraction pattern by now measured on a JP Moy detector at ESRF, electronic detector, and here's the enzyme. And we could measure successively over this time sequence high-quality Lowy diffraction patterns. And here you can see the high-quality continuous electron density that we were able to achieve by this point from the Lowy data. And so on the right-hand side, as you feed the enzyme crystal directly with substrate, you can move to see developing electron density in the enzyme active site. And when you turn off the supply of substrate, then naturally the electron density disappears. And so directly from the experiment, you can see the amino acids that are involved in the catalysis. And so this is an example and an important refutation of the criticism that the enzyme molecules in the crystalline state are not active. And here they are, seeing directly that they are active. And there are various other ways to deal with that criticism, of course. Now, the Lowy method had been, and the work we were doing was being watched closely from the Grenoble neutron source. And in particular, the shortage of flux of neutrons clearly had the potential to harness the Lowy method. And if, as we'd shown, the high quality analyses were possible, then it would be applicable to the neutron situation. And so Clive Wilkinson and his colleague Gary McIntyre, now in Australia, established a cold and a hot beamline for neutrons using the Lowy method. And through a donation of an image plate, neutron sensitive image plate from Nobuo Niyamura in Japan, the program could develop in earnest. With Joseph Gilboa in the Weizmann Institute, who was interested in the lectin protein concanavalin A and could grow quite large crystals of different crystal forms of con A, and my student Matthew Blakely, who's here, and his supervisor Dean Miles, we were able to explore ourselves the measurement of neutron Lowy diffraction data by now up to a 50 kilodalton protein, the glucoside-bound concanavalin A. And so the headline is to resolve the protonation states of amino acids that, like histidine and aspartic and glutamic acid. And here you see that the work that Suzanne Weisgerber, who came from Bonn in Germany to work with me, using the CONA, we were able to investigate the protonation state of the, for example, the histidine 24 here, where you see the nuclear density and the doubly protonated histidine. And that's using a diffraction resolution on the neutron data around 2.5 angstrom. This, of course, complements X-ray measurements. The Con-A will deliver very high diffraction resolution X-ray, and through a bond distance analysis or the difference electron density map, you can actually see, on, for example, shown here, the protonation state of the aspartic acid. The Con-A is indeed Jack Bean Con-A of the children's story, and here are actually five of the beans that J.B. Sumner used to work with his different proteins in Cornell. Sumner won the Nobel Prize in 1946, and when I was on sabbatical in Cornell, I was shown Sumner's personal supply of jack beans, and would I like to have some? And I said, yes, please, five. On the bottom right here is the book by Alberto Pagani and Nobuo Nomura, providing a splendid summary of all of the developments in neutron protein crystallography published within the IUCR book series. Now, a final highlight, and cited in the Max Perutz Award citation, is our work on the marine coloration in lobster shell. It's a curiosity-driven project. Here you see Naomi Chayen, whose work growing the beta crustacionin on the one hand, the blue-coloured crystal here, and the apocrustacionin provided the basis for our crystallographic investigation. Michela Cianci, who's here, came from Padua to work with me, and Andre Olzak from Poland. And we were able to determine, using data measured on the three different instruments, the SRS 7.2, 9.6, and 9.5, we were able to solve the apocrustacionin A1 protein. This is without carotenoid, and the structure, however, served the basis using molecular replacement to solve the beta crustacionin, the with carotenoid protein crystal structure. And so this showed two astaxanthins held by both of the protein subunits, and the conformational, the geometric arrangement of the astaxanthin was altered over the free form. And here you see a crystal of the free astaxanthin, and of course I've put the cooked lobster next to the astaxanthin on its own crystal, and you can obviously see that I'm suggesting strongly that the colour of the two is related. And then the live lobster, the black, is closely linked to the structure and layout of the astaxanthin when it's bound to the protein. And we published these in PNAS and Actacris D. And of course, the science of macromolecular crystallization has moved on a great deal. And the efforts of the International Conference on the Crystallization of Biological Macromolecules has, over a substantial period, been transforming crystallization from an art to into a definite science in our field. And here's the book that Naomi and a former student of mine, Eddie Snell, have published. The interest from the public and school children in this work was unexpected, at least to me, and enormous. The newspapers, the radio, the TV, and the what you might call the learned scientific magazines took a great interest, and Naomi and I gave many interviews. This is one example. It's a particular favorite, from the Liverpool Daily Post. Solution cooked up to red lobster riddle. And in the column, first column, we're referred to as boffins, and I don't know what it is, but it's somehow quite agreeable to be referred to as a boffin. Now, I'd like to finish on connecting specifically with Max Perutz, who is a great inspiration for all scientists. And I've chosen aspects of his thoughts on science from his book, Is Science Necessary? And in here, he details in answering the question, the importance of science in food production, science in health, science in energy. It is a very cogently argued case. And of course, I think, speaking for all of us, we would like to imagine that our work has got social and economic impacts of the science that we do. And probably the best example of that is the work that I've done within the Darsbury Analytic Research Technical Services serving industry. And in the early 1980s, I provided the first options for how pharmaceutical industry could be served by the SRS 7.2 and 9.6. And then much later, having in fact reached director of SRS, and with colleagues Elizabeth McLean and Pierre Iscala, I summarized with them the importance of protein crystallography in industry and the role of synchrotron radiation. The Research Council's UK, after the closure of SRS, undertook a detailed analysis of the social and economic impact of the Darsbury SRS between 1981 and 2008. Within that, the protein crystallography on the SRS was a highlight. It was highly commended as a major contribution as part of the overall social and economic impact of the SRS. And so I would like to think that Max Perutz himself would bless at least this small contribution in these rather general headings that he highlighted in his book. But he also refers to the importance for us as scientists and the need to have a delight and a wonder at the works of nature. And that is on his review of a book by Peter Medawar, How to Become a Scientist. And so it's obvious that with the example of the lobster coloration, how the color changes on cooking relates to the layout geometrically and electronically of the carotenoids in the protein. The mystery of why the North, the European and the North American lobster has this black color and the Australian and the South African lobster is red is investigated by molecular biology and various techniques. And it's one of those mysteries of life on Earth that brings us into contact. And I think that I, again, would like to imagine that Max Perutz would bless the fact that this is a delight and wonder at the works of nature. The acknowledgements obviously involve a lot of contributions, and I've tried to highlight through the photographs and the mentions of colleagues and students their role in all of this. I heartily thank all my PhD students and postdocs and collaborators. The Darsbury Laboratory, the aerial view shown here at the top left, and the universities of York, Oxford, Keele, and Manchester have been paramount throughout. I heartily thank all the synchrotron radiation and neutron facilities for their collaboration and all the software developers. The funding agencies were extensive. The UK Science and Engineering Research Council, the Swedish Research Council, NATO, the Wallenberg Foundation, the European Community, the Biology Biotech Science Research Council, Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, the Wellcome Trust Charity, the Leverhulme Trust Charity have all played a major role throughout all of this. In the logos at the bottom, the importance of Diamond, the Institute Larry Langevin, the ESRF, and the EMBL in Hamburg have all and continue to play a very important part in the work that I'm continuing. But I also especially thank my wife, Dr. Madeline Helliwell, whose work I've featured, and I had the pleasure to take part, and all her support and friendship and our life together. I also wish to thank Madeline. I leave you with some favorite images. Obviously, the ECA and the ECM29 will forever remain very much close to my heart and mind, and the pleasure of this evening and the pleasure we look forward to through the week, and the different projects that I've highlighted for you. And here's a picture, actually, when I was director at SRS within the SRS 7.2 hutch. But I thank you all for your attention, and look forward to discussing and meeting with you again through the week. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Helliwell. To all of you, thank you for being here. Welcome and enjoy the conference. Now may I, on behalf of the organizing committee of the 29th European Crystallographic Meeting, invite you all to the reception, which will be held in the Hall A, Exhibition Hall of the Adris Exhibition and Convention Center. Thank you very much.